everyone. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right, that's your cue throughout the service. If anyone up here says he is risen, your response is he is risen indeed. So let's try that again. He is risen. Praise the Lord. We're so glad that we are here for Resurrection Sunday services. A few housekeeping things. If you don't already know, the restrooms are in this building right over here. Just one person per restroom at a time. And so the women's are right here, men around the corner. So if you need to use the restroom, that's where they are. If you haven't picked up a bulletin yet, the bulletins are back there on the back table. And if you turn your attention to the announcements, first announcement is we're going to have a business meeting. First business meeting in quite some time, in 2 weeks, and we'll just do it right after worship service here. I'll have some materials out next week to say what we're going to be presenting, what we're going to be talking about. And so business meeting in 2 weeks, hopefully, we'll see if we can get people to join us virtually as well. Offering bowls, there's an offering bowl here. There's also an offering bowl in the back. If you want to use an envelope, you're welcome to use an envelope. But if you're writing a check, you can just write the check and drop it in the bowl. You don't need to use an envelope for that. But if you want to, they're there and you're welcome to. Pretty much all of the Zoom and YouTube gatherings are still meetings. So if you want to join us for any of those, all the information is on the back of your bulletin. So you can go take a look at that. We'd love to have you join us. If you haven't joined us in the past, we'd love to have you join us now. And one of the other things coming up is, this is in about 2 weeks, is the Women's Missionary Union. They're going to have their 2021 annual meeting on April 17th. That's a Saturday. It's going to be at 10 a.m. online. You can register online. It's not, even though it says women's, it's not just available for women, but men can come, are welcome to join as well. But thank you very much for being here this morning. It's not morning. I think we're all used to saying good morning. I have to catch myself saying that it is the afternoon. But good morning to everyone who's watching on YouTube. We're glad that you folks are here today. Let me open us up in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much that we are here today. We praise you and thank you that we can come before you and celebrate your resurrection, Lord. Let us never forget how precious that is to us and all that you have done for us, Lord. Bless our time of worship, and as we lift up our voices, lift up our hearts to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Amen, amen. Happy Easter, everybody. We're going to start with our first song. It's entitled Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Please feel free to join us. You can stand, you can shout, you can clap, or you can just sing. All right. us. Lord, I lift your name on high. Worship with the song entitled Above All.
Above all power, above all nature and all creative things, above
hello again. Oh, nobody wanted to say hello to me again. That's okay.
Hello.
Happy Resurrection Sunday once again. He is risen. You know, even though we won't be having our regular brunch afterwards, you know, it's still a special day. It's still wonderful to be in the house of the Lord today. You know, I hope that you have some kind of fun plans after service today, getting together with loved ones and, you know, continuing to think about all that Christ has done for us and continuing to dwell on that. But right now, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you so much that we can gather together, that we can enter into your house, Lord. And we pray that at this time, that as we study your word, that your just words may be revealed to our hearts so that we can know you more, we can love you more, we can serve you more. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever heard a story that was just so amazing that you're like, I can't believe it? You know, it's not real. You know, in today's day and age where everyone has a camera in their pocket, everyone's on like Facebook and Instagram, a lot of people say, if it's not on Facebook, it didn't actually happen. You ever heard anybody say that? If you don't have video proof of it, it didn't actually happen. Well, there was an incident that, you know, I was thinking about, you know, these kind of crazy things. And I remember one of these crazy events that I grew up knowing that this happened. And, you know, everyone has said that this happened. But it's from sports history. And it's really one of the craziest records. And really, it's one that I had a hard time believing for many, many years. It's the story of Wilt Chamberlain scoring 100 points in an NBA game. And this happened all the way back in 1962. And there's no video evidence of this. You know, there's no video evidence of him scoring 100 points. There's just a picture. And here's the picture. That's pretty much all they have. Evidence of him scoring 100 points. This is all that existed from like 1962 until 1988. Because eventually in 1988, there was some radio broadcast that surfaced that had the fourth quarter. And so they got that. Past that, you know, there really was no evidence. And so a lot of people were skeptical. I was skeptical of it growing up. There was a lot of other people who were skeptical because the details were just so sketchy about it. And 100 points. Nobody expected anybody to score 100 points in an NBA game. Like, it's just preposterous to score that many points. And, you know, there are very little details, very little evidence that this had happened. And so claims like this can be pretty hard to swallow at times, you know, partly because they're just too incredible to even think about. You think about the word incredible, not credible. And also, it was just so unexpected. Nobody expected anybody to score 100 points in a basketball game. Well, we're going to read a passage today from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12, where the disciples are also faced with something pretty incredible and something pretty unexpected. So turn with me to Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12, where you can follow along on the TVs. The resurrection. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found a stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. So So we're continuing our series through Luke, and I decided to jump ahead since this is Resurrection Sunday. I decided to preach on the resurrection itself. We're going to go back to chapter 6 starting again next week, but I thought it'd be appropriate to jump ahead for this story. And today's story, really, it is just the beginning of the resurrection story. How many of you remember last Easter's message? Oh, I'm glad I see everybody's hands raised, just so everyone out there knows. Everyone's hands is raised. Last year's Resurrection Sunday service was actually the verses that are immediately following this, verses 13 through 35. So if you want to know more of the resurrection story, you can tune into that on YouTube. Go check that out. It's the Road to Emmaus story. You can see some of the continuing story that Jesus has. It's listed under Luke 24, 13 through 35, under the playlist Luke Sermons, you know, if you want to find it by searching. But in today's story, we see the disciples receive evidence of the risen Lord. They hear testimony of the risen Lord. And that's really the main point of these verses. And if you're following along with the fill in the blanks, Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen. He is risen. Yeah, gotta stay on your toes. I'm gonna throw those out every once in a while. But you know, all of this evidence, all of this testimony points to the fact that Jesus is risen. He is no longer dead. And this was so completely unexpected, but that, you know, even the disciples, and most people in general, but even the disciples, they have a hard time believing that this is actually what happened. And I don't blame them, because somebody coming back from the dead, that's so much greater than someone scoring 100 points in basketball, which is already, you know, an amazing feat. But this is so much more amazing. Jesus, as risen, is so outside of their expectations, so outside of their thought process, that it is tough for them to believe this. So, but let's see how all of the evidence in today's events point to the fact that Jesus is risen. It occurred on the first day of the week. You know, Luke sets that out right from the beginning. This is typically why most Christians worship on Sundays, which is the first day of the week. And on this Sunday, women who are named later in the verses as Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, mother of James, as well as others, they were taking spices to the tomb of Jesus. And now, a little bit of a timeline for the lead-in to what's going on here. Jesus was crucified on Friday. It was what we recognize as Good Friday. And he was crucified just before sundown. And at sundown is actually when they considered Saturday starting. And Saturday was their Sabbath, was their day of rest. And so once the sun set, they wouldn't have been allowed to do any work. And so with Jesus being crucified just before sundown, it gave Joseph of Arimathea, who buried Jesus, just enough time to get Jesus into the tomb. But pretty much no additional time past that to do anything else. So these women were going very early on Sunday morning because this was really the first chance that they would have to go and honor the body of Jesus, you know, basically say their goodbyes, do whatever they could for the body with these spices, you know, anointing Jesus. But when they arrived at the tomb, they see that the stone has been rolled away, which in itself was no small feat. Other gospel accounts had the women wondering to themselves, talking to themselves, how are we going to move this giant stone that's been laid in front of the tomb? Because what they did is they would have a large circular stone, and you know, they would dig like a trench right in front of the entrance to the grave, and they would take that stone and they would drop the stone into there, so it would be set in place. And so it wouldn't have been anything easy to move, certainly trying to get it out of a rut. And so to see the stone rolled away, this already would have been quite unexpected to them, because who would go so early in the morning? It's like getting to church before the Kubels. Nobody gets to church before the Kubels. That's kind of what they're wondering. It throws them off already. So they enter the tomb to check out what happened, and only to find it empty. Nobody was in there. Get it? Nobody. Nobody. Okay. And this didn't make sense to them because, you know, they're probably thinking, who would want to steal a body? Jesus was not someone who was wealthy. You know, there were known grave robbers at the time, but they would rob wealthy bodies who were often buried with different treasures on them, different valuables. And so they're wondering, why? Why would anybody do this? And probably were debating this possible logical explanations among each other when more amazingness and really more confusion happens right before their eyes. You know, it says, very suddenly, two men appear out of nowhere, and I think that's startling enough, but it also says that they are described as wearing clothes gleaming like lightning. Can you wrap your mind around what that looks like, clothes gleaming like lightning? You know, I can't wrap my mind around what that could possibly look like. And I think the women probably couldn't wrap their minds around what was happening as well. And these was like, words can't fully describe what's going on. And they were so awestruck and in fright, we see them bow down in reverence. And the physical appearance of these two men, while it was impressive, it was not the most impressive thing, because they actually had a more impressive message. They start off by saying, why do you look for the living among the dead? You know, this is such a great line. You know, it's kind of funny, kind of sassy, but it's so true. If the women were looking for Jesus, they're not going to find him in a tomb, because a tomb is where dead people are. And Jesus is not dead. He is not here. He has risen. Jesus is alive. He is risen. So stop looking for him where you would look for a dead person. And they tell these women, you should already know this. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. You know, and these teachings refer to a number of teachings that Jesus had given throughout his ministry. He doesn't teach them all in like one concise teaching, but he's talked about all these different things on many different occasions. And even though these women were not officially disciples, they would have been among those who were listening, those who were learning from Jesus on his travels. So when they heard this, they remembered what Jesus said, and it all came together for them. And they had received this awesome proof, and now they run off to tell the 11, who would definitely want to know about this. You know, we were introduced to the 12 last week. We heard about the 12 disciples, the 12 apostles. Anybody remember all of their names? Peter, James, John. Yeah, it kind of gets fuzzy after that. But, you know, we heard about the 12. We talked about the 12. And they're not just disciples. They're also, once again, referred to as apostles. Because Jesus is still going to send them. He's still going to send them out into all the world, all the corners of the earth. And it seems like they were all gathered together in one place, probably the place where they've been staying that last week of Christ's life as he did ministry in Jerusalem. And, you know, when these women tell the 11 about what had happened, these 11 are so excited, right, that Jesus is risen. All right, great. Let's all rejoice together. That's exactly what happened in this story, right? No, that is not what happened in this story. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Literally, this word for did not believe, they had no faith. They had no faith in the women, because for them, the story didn't add up. It was so illogical to them, so outside of what they expected. They could not possibly grasp how this could happen. You know, it didn't fit their expectations. It didn't fit their worldview. You know, Jesus died. They saw Jesus die. You know, they saw Jesus be buried. And people don't come back from the dead, especially when they're crucified on a cross. This is just ridiculous to them. You know, some people say, well, back in those days, women's testimony wasn't accepted as valid. But these are women that they had traveled with. These are women that they had known. These are women that they could trust. They had no reason not to believe what was going on. And this is so outrageous. The 11, they couldn't believe without firsthand proof, which they'll get later. And then the women can say probably their favorite thing to the 11 at that point, which is not recorded in the Bible, but I assume that it's there. I told you so. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Peter wanted to see for himself what these women were talking about. So he went to the tomb. You know, it says bending over. This has the idea of, you know, peering in closely. He really was investigating thoroughly to find out what was going on here. You know, and he still didn't believe, even after seeing the strips of linen that were lying in the tomb, the empty tomb, he didn't understand that Jesus is risen. You know, of course we know Jesus is risen. You know, women knew that Jesus is risen, and that's what they were trying to tell them. But a lot of times it's difficult to wrap your mind around something that is so foreign and so audacious to your regular thoughts. You know, it's kind of why that 100-point game that I shared about, you know, so many people just had a hard time believing it because it was so unexpected. A lot of people were like, is it even possible? Yeah, we've seen people score 50, 60, 70 points. But at that point, no one had even gotten to 80, let alone 90 or 100 points. It was so unexpected. And so, you know, I went and I recently read about the history of that 100-point game. And it's a pretty ridiculous game. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but they weren't playing basketball the way basketball was supposed to be played. In the fourth quarter, his teammates were just fouling the other team to try and stop the clock and get the ball back. And it wasn't a close game. They were just doing this to try and feed the ball to Wilt. They were passing up wide open shots for themselves to pass the ball to Wilt so he could shoot more and hopefully get to 100. And so there's a lot of collusion that went into trying to get Wilt to 100 points. And so some people kind of look at that and it's like, it's kind of a tainted stat. It wasn't a really true statistic. Luckily, you know, the resurrection is not tainted. There was no human collusion involved. Some people think, oh, the disciples kind of cooked up this entire thing. You look at their reaction today, their absolute surprise, their disbelief. They didn't make any of this up. You know, none of them were even expecting Jesus to come back from the dead. But the fact remains that Jesus is risen. And the story doesn't end here. You know, as I said, there's a number of other stories in the gospel accounts that you can read about. Go ahead and read that on your own. You can watch last year's Easter sermon, Resurrection Sunday sermon. You can hear about the road to Emmaus. But the resurrection story doesn't even end with all of these accounts that happen in the Bible. It continues on, even today, because it's not just that Jesus has risen, past tense. Jesus is risen, present tense. Jesus is risen, and it still has ongoing implications for all of us. It still has ongoing meaning for you. So I have three things for you today. First of all, remember Jesus' words. Remember Jesus' words. Have you ever had a time in your life where you just been in doubt of what's going on and what's happening? The correct answer is yes. I think all of us have those times in life. You know, we have doubt, we have fears, you know, we go through times of trials. At those times, what we need to do is we need to fall back on Christ's words, on the words of Jesus. He has made us promises in His word that He will never go back on. He has given us assurances to get through the tough times. He has proven through history, He has proven through scripture that He has a 100% track record and that you can continue to rely on Him today. You know, at times, we may need reminders. You know, we may need a reminder similar to like the women got. Remember how He told you. Remember how He told you in His word. Jesus has given you all the answers already. It's just up to you to remember them and put your faith in them. So get into His word. You know, in your time of devotions, your personal Bible studies, get into His word. Get into His word with corporate Bible studies, with group Bible studies, because that's a time where you can study with other people. You can hear what other people, how it's changed their lives, how it's affected their lives, and how Christ is continuing to work in their lives now. When life seems hopeless, when life seems uncertain even, His word is meant to encourage and give life. Remember Jesus' words. Second, tell what you've seen. Tell what you have seen. When you see something amazing, don't you want to go and tell anyone and everyone who would listen just how amazing that was and just what you've witnessed? Anybody? Anybody want to do that? When you see something awesome, don't you want to share that with others? I see a couple heads nodding. Hopefully you do. You know, after Wilt Chamberlain's 100-point game, there were 40,000 people who claimed that, yeah, I was at the game, which is impossible because the arena doesn't hold 40,000 people, and NBA games back then, you know, usually weren't more than a third full of capacity. But it just shows that so many people wanted to say that they were part of this amazing event. You are part of an amazing event in history. You are part of Christ's resurrection. You are part of the fact that Jesus is risen. You know, you may not have been there when it happened, but he continues to live in you and me today, in all of his people. And so we bear witness to the most amazing thing that has happened in all of history. Don't downplay the importance of that. Don't downplay the importance of different things that have happened in your life, of how God has changed your life, of the difference that Jesus has made. Tell others about these things. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. Tell what you've seen. You know, others need to know that Jesus has died for them. Others need to know what Jesus has done for them. You know, be willing to tell people why you chose to follow Jesus in the first place. Be willing to tell people why you continue to choose to follow him even today. Be willing to tell of the works that Jesus has done in your life and around your life, the ways that he has delivered you through trials, the way he delivered you through difficulties. Be willing to tell of the comfort and encouragement that he brings in your times of need. Tell what you've seen. And lastly, be patient with unbelievers. Be patient with unbelievers. Even when you tell someone the truth, and it's the absolute truth, they may not believe you at first and different times. You know, be patient with them. Do you automatically believe everything that everyone tells you? No, we don't. Why not? Well, there are some people that are not so trustworthy in the world. But you believe everything that your pastor tells you when he tells you, right? Yeah, they're laughing. Everyone's laughing in here. I don't know why they're laughing. But, you know, sometimes people tell you things, and even if it comes from a trustworthy source, it just sounds like nonsense at times because it doesn't fit your worldview. Think of what unbelievers, you know, when they hear about Jesus Christ, they hear about Jesus resurrected 2,000 years ago, and they're like, what does that have to do with my life? You know, it doesn't really fit into my worldview. I don't really care about that. Why should I care about that? Also, you know what else is not in most people's worldview and they don't like to think about? They don't like to think about the fact that we are all sinners and our sin deserves death. Most people don't like to think about that. It takes time to break into someone's thought process. You know, things that are just complete nonsense to them, they don't like to think about these things. It's a difficult truth to come to terms with at times. And that's what unbelievers are going through. Be patient and know that God is at work in their lives. Paul has a great analogy. And the Apostle Paul, you know, has a great analogy. He says, you know, we can plant the seeds. We can water the seeds, but only God can make them grow. And you think about a seed in the ground. You know, we can't see exactly what's going on down there. You know, but we can continue to plant. We can continue to water. That's what God has called us to do. Continue to do that. Continue to witness in words as well as in your actions. And know that God is working in ways that you may not see. Don't give up. You are making a difference in their lives. Be patient with unbelievers. I'm going to invite the praise team to come back up at this time. But I'm going to remind everyone that the resurrection is the greatest historical event ever. And it was all done for you. Christ died for you. Jesus didn't come to earth for his own sake, but he came to earth for you because he loves you. You know, and he knows that you have sin in your life and that you can't fix sin on your own. And he didn't want you helplessly flailing about in your sin. He provided you an opportunity to just come to Jesus. Jesus is the answer. He's the one who can atone for sin through his sacrifice and his resurrected life. And for us, it begins with a prayer. You know, if that's a prayer that you've never said this morning, you know, pray this prayer with me right now. Jesus, I know that I am a sinner in need of forgiveness. I believe your resurrection proves your victory over sin and death and provides me with salvation. Forgive me and live in my life. Amen. Now, if you said that prayer for the first time today, you now have Jesus Christ living in your heart. You have his Holy Spirit living in you. You can now experience the joy of having new life in him. Just as he rose from the dead, you have now been raised to new spiritual life. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen in you and he is risen in me. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your resurrection. We thank you for so many who have testified to what you have done in the past, Lord, to bring us to where we are today. We ask that you continue to use us to just shout your praises, Lord. That you continue to use us to be your apostles sent out into the world. We pray all this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I'm going to turn it back over to the praise team. And after that, I'll ask Lance to close us up in prayer.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Shane. I know on your bulletin it says Christ the Lord is risen today. We're actually going to change that to the song's entitled Written in Red. And exactly what Pastor Shane's been talking about. You know, we celebrate the risen Christ. Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this being with us to this Easter service today. And thank you, Heavenly Father, for having so much of our congregation here feeling safe to come and gather and worship you. It just feels like a family starting again, and that we are worshiping you together. So thank you for that. Thank you for Pastor Shane and his message today. And we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is risen. We thank you for all of these things. We ask your continued blessing upon our earth as it gets healed from our pandemic. We ask that you minister to all of our families who have encountered difficulty during this time. But most of all, Heavenly Father, let us continue to worship you with our faith, our love, and continue to always be with you. All of these things we ask and pray in the precious and holy name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.